Hey everyone, Rascal here.
And Mama, welcome to our podcast.
Today we're covering seasons 2 and 3 of the Netflix series, The Dragon Prince.
Continuing the Avatar-esque adventure, our heroes are getting closer to the Dragonlands while the villains are not far behind. Then in season 3, things heat up when a great evil is being unleashed.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We saw it coming.
Yeah, but this the intensity you just couldn't predict.
We saw it coming, but didn't know how.
Right. And the episodes are pretty much the same length. I mean, minus the last one of season 3, which was slightly longer. I think it was a full 30 minutes, like, with no commercials or anything, as if it was on TV. So, yeah, it was really, both of these seasons were really great. And so far, each season has been fantastic.
Sokka's instincts.
Right. And I think they were saying there's going to be 6 seasons, one for each element that they have in the show. Okay. Kind of like Avatar did 3 books for 3 elements that were still being used. Mm-hmm. So we can expect the show to last much longer instead of next season being the last season now.
Okay. We also did season 1 last year. If you want to take a look, it's probably a card attached where you can take a look at that if you're not familiar with The Dragon Prince, mm-hmm. and find out what happened in the beginning as the story continues.
Right.
So season 2.
Yeah, well, season 2, remember season 1 kind of had them journeying from the kingdom all the way to Dragonlands, and then the egg hatched. So now with seasons 2 and 3, they had to take the dragon down. Now it's harder to do because now it's moving around.
And he's so cute.
And it doesn't know how to fly because it doesn't have the queen dragon to teach it, so they've been trying to teach it to fly, but it doesn't work because he's been on the ground so much. It's not like one of the, it's supposed to be one of the first things they learn, but none of them can fly, so they kind of have to pretend they can or just tell him, oh, you can fly.
Right, and his little Callum's little brother, mm-hmm. has an affinity with animals, so the baby dragon immediately attaches to Ezran, and they have a way of communicating, and he goes to him for protection.
Right. Mm-hmm. And is and like I said, it's funny because they have this little bonding moment, Olivia, like the entire season, because I think he's constantly carrying him the whole time since, you know, he can't fly. Mm-hmm. He's got to carry him, you know, everywhere and hide it from people that might want to take it. Like I said, now that it's hatched, so now it's a little more difficult to get across these places. So that provides, you know, new challenges.
Okay.
And they still have the sort of A story and B story.
Mm-hmm. And C story.
Right, yeah, and C story. Only this time now, they have this thing with this guy who's, what's his name? Averroes, who's, I guess, their version of Lotor, but with a way too deep voice that doesn't really fit the character. Because you think it's something a little lighter, but then you listen and he's talking like this. It's like,
not
that doesn't
Tor.
Work.
He's really creepy. Lotor wasn't creepy, which mm-hmm. is why he ended up with a gaggle of fans. But this guy is creepy, mm-hmm. and in no way charming, or in no way would you think that he is has any good intentions. You know
no.
his intentions are just
right. Bad. And yeah, and then, yeah, as it goes on, you kind of start, who's the mystery of this guy, and then as revealed, he just wants out of the mirror, which I guess is his prison.
Right, in season 2, he appears as this caterpillar?
Yeah.
Or some type of
crawly
bug
thing
that goes into Soren's ear.
I think Soren's the son, right? So I think it's Viren.
Viren's ear. Sorry. Goes into Viren's ear and talks to him and is his, I guess, his consultant and his guide, but no.
That,
for evil. Yeah, his
right.
consultant and guide for evil.
Right, and then he can see him visually instead of hearing him, you know, later on. Mm-hmm. And now, and then it just sort of becomes him lounging around and stuff. I'm like, but you're not out. I don't know what's going on here. It's like, is he okay? First he was this threat, and now he's just kind of chilling and stuff, and it's like, you're kind of lax for wanting to, you know, destroy all mankind, so.
And then you also have Ezran, who is being acknowledged as the true heir, because at first they thought he was dead and had been killed in season 1, mm-hmm. but they find out he's not dead in season 2.
Mm-hmm.
So, he's very young, very wise, very cute, and he's very childlike, but he also has this ability to know how to ask for help, to try to understand things that are beyond him, and to think with a true heart and make decisions. Mm-hmm. So he decides he's going to go back. He's not going to try to avoid taking the throne. He's going to go back and not worry about them trying to kill him. And the great thing is there were people in the kingdom who were loyal to his dad that are also loyal to him.
Right.
And they help him to get
Which is really different, because usually when they make the move of having a kid rule, they just don't want to acknowledge it. They're like, just no, you don't get the right anymore. All doing is the advisor or something is like really messed up. They don't even get a chance or anything. It's, or like with Bruce Wayne during the Gotham series.
Well, Darren doesn't want to acknowledge him. Darren doesn't want him
Definitely not.
He doesn't want him to take the throne because he's accepted a pro temp role as the ruler. And so by Ezrin taking his rightful place, that boots him out and he loses all his fake power he's amassed.
Right.
You know.
And there were times we thought someone else was trying to, you know, take the crown too, but no, they were genuinely trying to help him make the right decision. And for a while, like, he wasn't even sure because of all the crap that was going on around the kingdoms. They all wanted to declare war, start fighting, and join to start killing people and stuff. And he really was scared because he didn't want, you know, people to die just because of one rule or one choice. So it didn't become, like, something quick and easy, nor was something dragged out. It was just whenever you knew there was tension there. Mm-hmm. And he was really thinking on how to resolve it, not just trying to jump to one thing or the other. Mm-hmm. And then all you're thinking, oh, this is the great thing. And then it turns out it wasn't. You should have gone with the war part.
Right.
Because that's what it seemed like. No, you gotta do war. That's the only way to do it.
And, right, the people of the other kingdoms, except for one ruler who was also a child, a female, they all wanted war. And, oh, you don't want to do war? Well, you're a bad ruler. You need to get out. Which became really
prominent for season 3, right?
Yeah. So two more things I think are important we should mention. One is we find out the mother dragon is not dead.
Mm-hmm.
And they're doing everything they can to try to awaken her so she can care for her baby. And then another thing is the ship that they clearly are letting you know is a thing in canon between Rayla and Callum.
Yes, yeah. They eventually get to it, like, third season. But you could say they did wait a while before they got really, actually season 3 this time.
Well, I think in season 2 there were clear-cut clues that this was going to happen.
Oh, okay, yeah. Okay, I understand. Yes, you're right, there were. Because it looked like she was about to confess, and then, like, there was a part in season 2 where he was sort of exposed to dark magic because he couldn't get the hang of the light magic, and they thought maybe this wasn't his thing, but he really wanted to be a magic wielder. And there was sort of this inner conflict, like with Zuko, where he was really being tempted by the dark part of himself to use dark magic, and he had to fight it, and he wasn't responsive for, like, days. So this was, like, going on for a while. And, yeah, you're right, that's when that started. So that was ended up being a conflict that went to season 3 when he started using the magic and became used to it, but it wasn't the dark magic.
Okay, so now we can talk about season 3, the A, B, and C, and shipping stories.
Right.
So, as you were saying, let's go with that one first about the ship and
Might as well get that over with.
Right, since we ended with it, let's start with it for season 3. So they've officially become a thing.
Right. And like I said, it's a good thing it didn't, like, just start immediately. You knew it was going to come, but it didn't, like, immediately do that stuff in the very beginning. They just let them develop naturally, you know, their friends and stuff, and you knew someone's gonna come eventually. You just don't know who was gonna like who first. So it was kind of like Star, and it wasn't anything where it was kind of in your face.
Right,
that's a really, really good thing. I mean, they mentioned it like an episode or two, then it stopped, then it came back, and then when it started becoming clear, it was getting harder for them, for Rayla to hide it.
Right,
and then it started becoming more and more focused and obvious.
And then, like you said, like Star, she kissed him, and then, oh, no, I'm sorry. Then he kissed her. No, I'm sorry.
Like, what? Like, you don't have that many episodes left this season. Just get over with.
Right.
But, yeah, and that was kind of the funny part. It was just like, she's just elf assassin. Well, used to be an assassin. Right. And you also get her, you know, story about what happened with the village, what happened while she was gone, which we'll get to.
Which really is something we can't reveal if you haven't seen it. Because it's a really big surprise. But thinking she has no allies and no one who cares, she does learn that one person still cares, although he fears retaliation from the rest of their group or tribe. And but he does attempt to help her in some way. Right.
And we will say there was actually a theory in the beginning of the series that people had made about Rayla's brother, which actually did turn out to be true thanks to clues given in the end credits of the first season with the drawing. So congrats to the fandom for correctly guessing the theory long before we even got to this point.
Right. So let's talk about Ezrin. As we mentioned, he finally reached the castle, and he said, I've come to claim my rightful throne. And he attempts to make decisions, and again, the other nations and stuff, for one, are against him. They want war. They want him to just go ahead and agree to declare war. When he won't, some of the other leaders get threatening, get really horrible toward this child. You need to step down. You can't do your job. Just really, really... horrid.
And they were kind of the same way with the girl queen in the other season, but it wasn't as harsh as
because Ezrin. She's older,
You know, and it's actually had done that longer,
right?
So they had been pretty used to that, even though some are kind of iffy about it. Still, they're used to it. With him, it's just like, no, you can't let this child rule. Just get an adult that will make the quote-unquote right decisions, meaning the decisions they want.
So the young lady, who's also, as you mentioned, a ruler, came to support him. And then he decided to start asking people that he felt he could trust their opinions, because he really, at one point, didn't know what to do. Because, again, this one particular person just kept threatening him and being very belligerent and very mean and yelling. So it kind of unnerved him. He didn't have Callum to ask, whom I'm sure he would have gone to, and Rayla as well. So he eventually gets their opinion, and he follows what they tell him to do as a result of demands made of the other nations. Without giving away any spoilers, that's what happens with that one.
And one more thing we definitely want to mention, besides the build-up towards the end of Season 3, and they get, you know, more allies, unexpected allies, because of how things are escalating towards there with the evil starting to gain more power. And you have also foreshadowing for what's to come in the next season. You also get more backstory.
Absolutely.
Considering backstory with how the war even started, how the kids lost their mother.
And how Viren played into becoming such a trusted ally of the king.
Right. And as well as showing what happened to the Dragon King, which ended up, you know, causing the prince to disappear and thinking it was dead. So, yeah, you do get a little more story on the characters. And, of course, everyone pretty much returned, including Ezrin and Callum's aunt. And she's with the, I guess I'll just call them, like, the lava elves or something, or sun elves. Something like that, because they got the moon elves. I think they're the sun elves because they got this lava place, and oddly enough, they have French accents, which I think is hilarious. Like, I don't know how that mixes. I don't know how that mixes with that, but okay. But yeah, and it was really fun, and you almost forgot about her translator. I'm like, oh, he is free. Okay, I'm like, they didn't get rid of him today. But that was just funny.
And then this season, they learn about the dragon baby actually living and surviving. And then that becomes a battle as well, them attempting to get him, whether it be to get power from him or to kill him. So that becomes another arc. It slightly changes from just protecting the egg and hatching the egg to protecting the baby from these crazy people.
Right. Oh, one last thing before we sign off. I definitely want to mention the amazing shout out to Avatar when they're traveling on the beast's back, and then it gets stuck, and the person that was trying to hunt them at first was starting to help them. He had to go down and get unstuck, and then her weapon actually has some things on top, and he said, and Rayla asked, oh, what are you looking at that for? It said, tell me about it. It's so familiar. Boomerang.
That was hilarious.
Oh, man, that's like the best part. Someone said friendships can last even lifetimes. Yeah. Like, yeah, the boomerang forever lives.
So if you've seen seasons 2 or 3 or both, let us know what you thought of it in the comments below.
Yes, and be sure to subscribe, like, and click the notification bell to get more updates on Paws videos.
And if you haven't seen it at all, it's available on Netflix, all 3 seasons. You'll love it and enjoy it, and it's going to be much different than you'd expect.
Yes. So, thank you so much for watching. I'm Ask Entertainment.
And I'm Mom Entertainment. Until season 4.
Have a toontastic day.
Peace. In the mountaintops, rivers, and streams, fucking sun.